Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 29. Before we get into anything, we're going to go with Jeremy with the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Yes, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT NoGov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today we have Anam Paiseanta, who's an anarchist and voluntarist. He's got his website, anampaiseanta.com. He's also on YouTube, Anam Paiseanta, and Facebook, same thing, Anam Paiseanta. So give him props for consistency. So he talks a lot about politics and spiritual ideas coming from voluntarism and anarchy. And he wrote a book called Three Friends Free, A Children's Story of Voluntarism. Which is not on my bookshelf. Unfortunately, I can't believe it's not.
For shame. Because
it should be there.
I don't have kids, so dang it. I got to have kids so I can buy the book.
The other ones, but yeah, it'll surely get there quite soon. So Anam, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
I'm stoked to be with you guys.
Yeah, I actually heard from through Dustin Hutchinson about you and you and him doing the videos and now through the book. I'm like, wow, you're in a lot of different venues, so it's pretty awesome. So before we get into the book and your spirituality with anarchy, can you talk a little bit about how you became an anarchist and voluntarist?
Yeah, I think that it's just always been an inclination to follow my own ideas and resist influence from others based on a title or some kind of a position that they've obtained. So it's kind of been that way since I can remember. So growing up, and I naturally gravitated towards economics books like Mises and Hayek and books about forging your own way in life by, maybe Tony Robbins type stuff, like redesigning your paradigms and rethinking old ideas and adopting ideas that are more productive in your life and go, to help you go to the direction that you want to go in. So when did I adopt like the actual term anarchist? I don't know, sometime maybe between 15 and 20 years ago. So it's been quite a while.
You got all of us beat.
Yeah, I'm the past like three, four years. I constantly say in the show, I voted for Obama in 2008, but not because I cared anything about Obama, but just because I grew up with a family of Democrats. So I thought, everybody just votes Democrat. That's just what you do, right? You vote for the subjugation of your neighbor. I mean, who doesn't do that?
Well, it seems like a lot of people come, that eventually get here have that mind, that kind of mind, that style of thinking, a mindset that they realize something's wrong, so they want to try an alternative. So I've noticed that about like a lot of Democrats are half right because they realize all the problems with Republicans. Unfortunately, though, and it goes vice versa as well, but unfortunately, they're still stuck in that right versus left, and they can't break out of it to realize that whole paradigm's put on us to keep us controlled, and they can't realize that they shouldn't be dividing amongst themselves, but they should be dividing amongst whoever's putting this idea on them. So they should break out of it completely. Eventually, though, we all have, and others that have this kind of outside-the-box thinking, eventually, even though we might try being a Republican at first because we realize something's wrong with the tax and spend ideas, or we might be a Democrat at first because we realize something's wrong with going to war over every single little thing. But eventually we like realize it's all kind of a mirage, and then we break out of it completely and go to that next level.
Yeah, man, that's, you nailed that. That was, I agree. It comes from that realization where you're like, wait a second, maybe all this is bullshit. you look at it and you go, wait a second, okay, let's just pretend that everyone's wrong here. What is right? And then you start digging into it, and you're just like, wow, this is just a game that people are playing. It's like they're passively playing a game, and they know it's a game, but people die from this. It's like the largest cause of unnatural death in the world is politics, and people just, they dance merrily while it happens. It's like, they what's on the Kardashians tonight? Oh,
Yeah, it seems like stuff is so messed up that it must be that way because somebody's benefiting from it.
Of course, yeah. And you look at how every country right now is a fascist country, from an economic stance, and everyone wants to blame capitalists, and there's not, you know, these one percenters that people want to rail on, especially the left and the Democrats. Not only is every politician that's railing on about the 1% in the 1% and getting paid by the 1%, but also government created the 1%. You know, I have an open challenge. We're 29 episodes in now. Show me one billionaire on the face of the earth that achieved that money without using government force. And once you see that, once a liberal sees that, it's kind of it can kind of be eye-opening, you know?
Yeah, if you want to quit feeling the effects of psychopaths controlling power, quit concentrating power.
100%.
All we need is the perfect person to rule. That's all we need. if we just have the right amount of violence in society, utopia will have been reached, right?
We just got to vote harder next time.
Oh, last time there, I made sure there was no Chads, man. I voted so hard. No, I actually gave up on voting last time. I was like, you know what? Romney or Obama and the two senators in my state, they're locked in. They've been locked in for 30 years. So it's like, what's the point? Why vote again? I live in Alabama. It's going to be a red state until it's not a state anymore, until Martians or whatever take over, and you know, so what's the point in voting in these gerrymandered lockdown states that, like Alabama, like Seattle, or I mean Washington, where you live, it's going to go Democrat almost every time. So why even vote?
Yeah, well, I'm proud to say that I've never voted.
Oh, nice. Wow.
You got me beat. I voted for voted for old George Bush a second time.
See that?
I actually didn't vote for a very long time, but not for any like philosophical stance or anything like that. I was so apathetic to everything. And you know what you were saying earlier about the left and the right and the people seeing like halfway and stuff. Like I mean we've discussed it before on the show, but I took like the longest possible route, because I started out as very apathetic for the first, you know, 8 to 10 years of my voting life, but I just called myself a Democrat just despite my parents who were Republicans. But I really didn't know what it meant because I was that apathetic that I was the prototypical, you know, useful idiot that just plodded along and voted when somebody said, okay, we're gonna vote for this guy. Okay, sure, why not? You know, like I didn't care, I didn't pay attention. And then when I started to focus and I started to, you know, when I started my own business and then, you know, the taxes started to affect me, I was like, hey, wait a minute. And that's when I slowly started to transition to paying attention and then realized that, oh, wait a minute. But it was the same thing. I was trapped in that paradigm. So I said to myself, well, if I'm not a Democrat, I must be more Republican. So I started shifting in that direction. And I considered myself conservative and I joined up with the Tea Party and, you know. And then I just kept going. And then I was like, well, this doesn't feel right either. So wait a minute, maybe there's something else. And then I was introduced to my first real life libertarian. And I was like, oh, okay, maybe this is what I am. But it's still, just like you said, still stuck in that paradigm, still saying, well, okay, maybe there's just this one other avenue. Maybe there's another avenue. Not let's step outside of the box. Let's find how to navigate within the box. That's all I kept thinking. And it wasn't until I started calling myself a libertarian and then I was introduced to my very first, you know, in-person voluntarist, the, you know, the first person who ever used that term with me, kind of blew my mind. And then I finally started to figure it all out. But it is, it's so common to see that from people where they just, they get frustrated and just switch to the other side. It's never even enters their mind to just get out of the game altogether. It's just, no, we'll just switch teams and it'll be better.
Well, it's understandable how people are have a hard time with objectivity about that and about seeing that there is a paradigm, because we were raised by, most of us anyway, we were raised by the government. We spent 7 hours a day, 5 days a week, 12 years with them. And on those days, I mean, we spent, what, an hour or two with our own parents. So it's no wonder that we have a lot of pro-government wiring still left over in our minds, you know.
And yeah. It's really scary how much time you spend. You know, now that you said that, you think back, it's like, yeah, I spent a few hours with my parents after when they got home from work, and then it was video games or TV after that, which is just spewing mostly underhanded statist propaganda all day. So it's, you know, you truly are raised by the state. You know, your parents believe in the state. You know, they're driving ideologies into your head. The school's driving ideologies in your head. The TV is. It's like there's no. You know, there's no chance for a kid to, you know, someone to say, hey, you figure this out. We're not going to tell you anything. You figure this out.
Yeah, that makes me happy that there's more homeschooling and unschooling happening now for that one reason. I think it's the number one important thing that a parent can do to help their child grow up more free in the mind.
Yeah, it's super encouraging. Danilo and Jeremy want to homeschool their kids. One of our viewers they literally, when they started hearing our show, started homeschooling their kid like, what, two or three episodes after they started listening. You know, 70% increase in the last 10 years in homeschooling. People are seeing that it's not working. These schools are pumping out idiots. And, you know, whether it be some kind of racial motivation or whatever, or religious, political belief, whatever, that you're getting your kids out of school, I'm all for it. Whatever you can do to get them out, you know. That's my stance on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of homeschooling parents that I meet, they talk about Common Core, you know, as if Common Core is a problem. Just get Common Core out of there and it's going to be all better. And, you know, and then I talk to them a little bit more and about, you know, taxation, about, you know, appeal to authority, appeal to antiquity. And then if I get them really comfortable, I send them the Josie Wales a prison by any other name, and that really blows their mind. So, I've gotten a couple of people, quite a few people, to you know, to really be interested in voluntarism through homeschooling and unschooling, because they're already questioning government schooling, right? So if I say to them, I say, you know, if government can't do education right, what about foreign policy? What about monetary system? You know, what about everything else? What about, you know, security, protection, right? So just go down the line.
Yeah, I mean, as Dave said, my girls, as I mentioned, they just turned 4, but we had the plan in motion before they were even born that we were going to be homeschooling them. And since then, I learned about unschooling, and now that's, I mean, I'm headed even more in that direction. But I agree that everybody, I find it very, a very important thing that I agree that I think, you know, more people, I wish more people were doing it. But it's funny that you said, Danilo, about the Common Core, because, I mean, I know a lot of those people, because I was, you know, as I previously mentioned, I was involved in the anti-Common Core movement before I finally started admitting that I was an anarchist. And they, a lot of those folks, yeah, they do. They think it's, oh, it's just this. It's, we just need to get rid of this, and then we can take control again. And I mean, I was trying to point out to some of these folks even before when I was still considering myself a minarchist, I was still trying to point out to them then that it's you know, the phrase that I used was, Common Core is not the problem. It's merely a symptom. It's not the disease. It's just the latest thing they've rolled out, because you know, other people want to go back and say, oh, well, it was No Child Left Behind, or it was, well, what was Reagan's one about the kids and reading, whatever. I don't even remember anymore, all this garbage they spew out. But it's not. It's the system itself. And who was I listening to today? Was it a Tom Woods episode? Maybe they were talking about the Prussian system. And you know, how that's, I mean, even before the Prussian system got implemented here, was the PhD system in Europe, where wealthy, the elites over here, back in the early 18th century, were shipping their kids over to Europe for these PhD program, you know, for the PhD programs, and then the Prussian system got instituted that way, because they came back, and they became part of academia. And they became, you know, the higher ups in different industries, and they started preaching their garbage, and it's been going on for a very long time. So definitely, you know, I too encourage people to not just, you know, look into homeschooling, but just get your kids out, because it's not healthy. I mean, it's the same thing as, like, you know, we've talked before about the spanking argument, where people are like, well, I went through public schooling and I turned out just fine. Mm-hmm. Are you an anarchist? No, you think government's necessary and that it's a good thing in some instances? I'd say you turned out very far from fine.
Well, I mean, so. I went through public school and I turned out all right.
Well, exactly.
So it must be good for everyone else, right? You know?
Well, that argument has been lobbed at me. You know, you went to public school and you turned out okay. Why are you against public school?
You know, you could even argue, though, from a non-political stance, it's incredibly inefficient. The things that you actually learn in public school, if you were just to learn from a tutor, mm-hmm. You know, you go for 12 years to learn the things that you really could learn in maybe 8 months.
Yeah.
I mean, what do you really learn in public school? I did all my learning since school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, after basic math, arithmetic, and writing and reading, which could all be done in a year by a tutor, everything after school is just indoctrination and a boondoggle for more teacher salary, more votes, more tax dollars to be spent. It's basically a daycare. It's a prison. You know, I think it's funny that the three biggest buildings in the town I live in is the Walmart, a church, and the school. You know, so it's just, you know, people see these things and they're, well, the school is one of the biggest things. It must be important. It must be needed. And, you know, it's just a big fucking boondoggle. That's all it is.
So Anam, can you go into your book, Three Friends Free, and talk about that and what it's about and like what inspired you to write it?
Three Friends Free is a story about three friends who live in a valley by themselves. And they each have their own specialty, and they trade the things that they make voluntarily. And then a stranger comes into their valley and convinces them to let him act as a kind of a security guard for them in exchange for contributions from whatever they produce. He gets too big for his britches, ends up becoming unsustainable, and the friends are faced with the problem of what to do to overcome this thing they've allowed into their lives and into their minds. So the three friends, that's kind of the part that the kids get out of it. And the book has excellent illustrations from a friend of mine who's a comic book illustrator named Chris McFan. The three friends' names are Poblock, he's a fisherman. Hente is a farmer. And Menson is a weaver. And they all represent and oppressed peoples that have been kind of taken over by governments, even by foreign governments, throughout history. So there's some allegory there about how government isn't only a current problem, but a historical problem.
I agree on that. I agree. Government's a government. Religion has been like a scourge upon humanity, but you know, It's the more we can illustrate and show people, especially younger kids, that these are problems that they're going to have to face, that there are going to be people out there that want to control them. I think that's a really good message you're sending out, man. That's just to fill in that,
the fisherman Poblock, this is the Irish word for the people. Mm-hmm. The word gente is the Spanish word. And so gente is a mestizo farmer. That's the Spanish word for people. Mm-hmm. And Menson, the African weaver, that's the word for people in South Africa. So I think it's the Afrikaans word for people.
Afrikaan. Yeah.
Cool. Wow. So in the book, do you actually clarify that analogy as like the protector is government, or you leave that up to the reader?
If you see the illustrations, it's pretty obvious that he's
Is it government. Okay.
Yeah,
he's kind of dressed vaguely like a cop.
Yeah, it's
I am very disappointed that you haven't got this book because I did recommend it to you when I bought it. I said before we started recording, I'm a huge fan of your book, and it's funny because I didn't realize, you know, as I said before the show, I didn't make the connection because I've had this book on my shelf and I've showed it to my kids a bunch of times and they've actually picked it out, which always, you know, puts a smile on my face. But you definitely can. You read it and you see the police. I forget what the police, but the policeman has a name, right? What's his name? I forget.
Arthur,
yes. And every year he gets a little bit bigger, but he does. He's got if you're anybody who pays attention to government in any capacity, it is kind of hard to miss. it's the cop that just keeps getting bigger and bigger every year, and the poor friends look like little boys by the end.
Oh my god!
Next to this guy who's just, yeah, it is a great book, and I mentioned to you too, the illustrations are what drew me in, because I went searching for a book on a children's book on voluntarism, and it was one of the first three to five results I got on Google by just typing in a combination of voluntarism and kids books. And I just looked at it and I saw the illustrations alone. I'm like, wow, these are great. I have to have this for my kids, because I got it for them when they were, I guess, two. So all they cared about were the colors and the pictures. So I'm like, this is perfect, because any other book I found about anarchy was just like silly little rhyming books and stuff like that. But I was like, but they also had a lot of mixed messages that I wasn't a big fan of. This was a very succinct story that I think is extremely well done, actually, compared to other stuff I've seen. I'm a huge, huge fan. Not to blow too much smoke up your ass, but I am a huge fan of the book.
I'm honored, man. Thank you very much,
Rasan. I mean, he's already got a beard. You don't have to, you know, you don't have to. Everyone immediately gets respect from me if they have a beard, you know? I mean, you could grow it a little longer, Anam, but, you know, you're doing your thing.
My kids, they when we see law enforcement, like, on the highways, they don't know them as police. They know them as road pirates. So when we pass by, he says, "Daddy, look, road pirates." I'm like, "Yep, that's road pirates." So you gotta get the proper terminology, right? Like, call things by their proper names. That's, you gotta begin like that, right?
You know, me and the girl will be driving, and like, I don't buckle up usually, and then I'll be like, "Baby, road pirate." And we're like,
the book that I have. It's a child's guide to anarchy, ABC, right? ABC, the child's guide to anarchy, and my kids, when they were reading that, they loved the word anarchy. They kept saying anarchy, anarchy. And my daughter was like a year and a half when we started reading it, I think, and she couldn't say anarchy. She's like, "Ankiki, I want to read Ankiki." So that was one of her words after mommy, daddy, Ankiki.
Is there a direct website that you can go buy this from? Is it yourname.com?
Yeah, if you go to anampaiseanta.com, I'll send you one signed.
Ooh.
Awesome.
In exchange for Bitcoin, and there's a QR code right there on the website. Or you can go to amazon.com and buy it regularly there.
Awesome. All right. Now, you said you were kind of into the spirituality kind of thing. Are you thinking about doing a child's book about, you know, maybe finding your own spirituality or anything like that? Has that crossed your mind?
Well, like I said before we started recording, I'm an unintentional author. I didn't really mean to, I didn't set out to try to be an author. I just put this book into print because it was a story that I told my girlfriend's children. Hmm. So writing another book, I'm not too sure about that at this time. I guess that's my most concise answer.
I mean, sometimes I guess it just hits you, you know, it's like... you know, just some days, like, just the most genius thought pops in your head sometimes, and, you know, and you forget it most of the time, but, you know, since you've already had experience with writing a book, this could be easily translatable.
I have been thinking about making a series of videos, kind of tying it all together, the spirituality and the anarchism together. So stay tuned for that.
So do you carry any kind of label with your spirituality? Like if I had to label myself, I'd probably be a pantheist, definitely not an atheist.
Right.
Whereas I believe Danilo and Jeremy claim to be atheist.
No label.
No label.
So,
that's
no.
So can you go into a little bit of description on your so you when you talk about spirituality regarding anarchy?
Well, when I try to explain it to other people, I just try to use all secular terms that I can. And so when you're observing yourself, there's levels of your awareness in yourself. There's like your consciousness and your subconsciousness and your emotional center. And then there's something that's somehow below your emotional awareness that you're not always in touch with, your sub-emotional reality. So that might be called also your spirituality. Our total experience here affects us on that level. And I think that is where our deepest reality is. And so I think that it kind of ties into my anarchism, because I believe that humans were sent here not to live a life designed by some ruling families somewhere, but we were supposed to search for our highest potential and our deepest experiences. So I put together a video called Spiritual Garden, and in it I describe that just an observation of a human, our bodies do basically two things. We bring in senses through our eyes and our ears and all that, and then our brain and our heart kind of decode these signals and make up a reality that's in our mind, right? The other thing that our bodies do is they try to live as long as possible. We have an immune system. We have certain anti-aging apparatus in our body. We have also reproductive capacity. So this says to me, these two observations, those are basically the only two things that the human body does. So I've kind of deduced from those observations that we're here to sense and sustain. So bring in experiences, and hopefully deep experiences, and try to live as long as possible. So that's kind of, that's the scientific observation that is the kind of the seed for all of my spiritual ideas, that we're supposed to have a really deep experience here, create lots of meaning, trade the hopes and dreams that is our mind's reality of the future. Our experience of the future is hopes and dreams, right? Our experience of the past is hopefully beautiful memories. And so we should always be striving to make the exchange as we move through our life from the past into the future. We should always be trying to get a really good exchange. Always be trading our hopes and dreams in for beautiful memories that create some kind of a really deep and lasting effect on us and those around us.
Sounds like you're an awesome dude to be around. sounds like you could turn a no one's depressed around you, huh?
Well, I don't know about that, but
you know, there's just some people, they give off a vibe, you know. Some people have said that about me, where it just, If I'm in a good mood, everyone around me is in a good mood. And, you know, I get that same vibe from you, Anam.
Thank you for saying that. Thank you.
Cool. So are you into the Taoism at all? Tao Te Ching? Yeah, because that's something that really affected me when I was in high school. I read that book and I'm like, wow, this is awesome. And that's kind of like, I'm an acupuncturist and herbalist, so that kind of got me into, you know, Chinese medicine and, you know, Taoism. And then that kind of, you know, I drew a lot of parallels between that and voluntarism, you know, basically, mm-hmm. You know, Lao Tzu, he's, you know, like when he talks, you know, it's like, you know, the soft overcoming the hard, right? Yielding and things like that. And to me, a lot of that is, you know, the absence of coercion. Right, and basically, he's one of my favorite quotes of his is the best ruler governs a country like you would cook a small fish, right? So when you cook a small fish, you do so very delicately, so as not to destroy the fish. So in the same way, the best ruler, according to him, would be one who governs a country and the people don't even think that that he's governing. They don't even think that he's there. He's behind the scenes, and things still get done. So,
well, some would say that God governs that way, if there is a God that, or what, that these rules that are in place in the world, kind of govern us on a subtle way like that. Natural law, some people call it. To answer your question, the words of Lao Tzu and the way of life and some Buddhist ideas really do resonate with me.
Yeah, I like a lot of Buddhist ideals, but you know, what I preach on this show is never take what another man says as 100% fact. Do your own searching. So, you know, most people, they give up their ration, they give up their own thought, they give up any kind of digging into the truth to a book or to what their parents said or what a teacher said. They said it, so you know what, I'll accept that as fact.
I definitely see that. It's basically the appeal to authority, you know. And that's not never is healthy, right? It's basically why, you know, when I raise my kids, I raise them not to be not I don't treat them as, you know, my property or my inferiors, right? I treat them as my equals, right? And I talk to them like people, not like they're under me, right? I don't talk as if they should listen to me just because I'm older or stronger, right? But rather they should listen to me because my advice has value and that they can see that it will improve their lives if they follow my advice. And if they don't, they can see the effects, the consequences that if they don't. So that's why they should listen. That's, you know, not because of force, right?
Yeah, good ideas don't need force.
I've struggled back and forth with the whole spirituality, religious aspects most of my life. It drives my wife nuts because she considers herself spiritual, but she was brought up, you know, very, not strictly religious, but she was sent to Catholic school and stuff like that. And, you know, I have a problem when it comes to my kids, because I, you know, like you were saying, Danilo, about, you know, trying to get them to come to certain ideas and show them why. Well, when it comes to all these discussions, I just try to shy away from them, not because I don't want to share my views with them, but I feel they're still too young to understand. Because I mean, that's something even my wife had admitted to me the other day, that she you know, she has a problem with me trying to keep them away from all types of discussion of religiosity and or spirituality in anything more in passing, because she would like them to. But she even said, well, you know, she thinks they should know about it, but it shouldn't be forced like it was on her. You know, that was a realization I think she just recently came to, because that's mm-hmm. the thing, when it's forced on you, it's hard for, you know, I grew up in a family that was very religious, you know, they're very, you know, strict Catholics. You know, my grand, you know, there's a lot of jokes that my grandmother should have been a saint, you know, she prays all the time. I can remember, it's funny, you know, I think the Pope's in town right now, right? I think that's, there's been a lot of talk about that. I was thinking back about that, because I can remember, I guess it was maybe 85 when the Pope came to Yankee Stadium, it was a big deal. I think that's when it was, and I remember my grandmother so excited that she would go. But you know, it was forced on me and my sisters. You know, my mom forced us into church and into going, and you know, and then she made a deal with me at one point, thinking that she was trying to get one over on me, telling me that, well, you just have to stick it out until your confirmation, and then it's up to you to decide after that what you want to do. And thinking that I would
my family, it was
just, you know, finish 12 years of school and then you can
exactly. But that was her her thinking was that I'll reach that point and then I'll make the quote unquote right decision to come back on my own. As soon as my confirmation was over, I bolted. You know, and I didn't look back for a long time. I considered myself an atheist right then and there and said, that's it, I'm done with this. But just like my first forays into politics, it was only kind of half-hearted because I didn't really put a lot of thought into it. I mean, just like any other former Catholic, in times of need or times of extreme distress, things like a quick abstract prayer to God would just slip out of my mouth or get into my thinking, because it's just like, you know, like the old joke, you know, in a foxhole, there's no atheist in a foxhole. you know, where people that swear up and down they're atheists will be praying to God if they're, you know, getting rained upon with bullets and bombs. So it, it would always happen to me. And then I went through a period. I had a very rough spot. I don't know, was that 6 or 7 years ago, maybe? And I found myself, I kind of locked myself in my garage one day, and I was very depressed, and I was just miserable about life. And it was extremely hot, and I may have actually been hallucinating, because I just locked myself in there and was just sweating profusely. It was over 110 degrees in the garage, easy. And I swore I heard voices, and I swore I heard God or somebody talking to me. And then all of a sudden, I was just like, oh, I'm not an atheist anymore. I believe again. But I wasn't going back to any religion. I was just thinking in a spiritual sense. And just, okay, maybe there's something out there, and it just, this is my way to connect to it. And then a few years later, I went through another about phase where I started going through logic and reason and evidence and going, well, there's no evidence for this. Well, God damn it, everything's, it's all a lie, whatever. So, I mean, Dave said that, you know, Danilo and I, we consider ourselves atheists. I mean, I, if you have to give me a label, I guess, but I, that's just because I don't have any evidence to point me further than that. A lot of people automatically assume that being an atheist means that you not only do you not believe in a God, but you think that there's never has been one, never can be one, never, you'll never be proved wrong. You'll never, you know, that's it. There's nothing. Well, I never learned that way. For me, what atheism is just not, it's not believing in a, it's not, you know, having a belief that there's no God. It's just not having a belief. Because there's nothing there, but it doesn't mean that if evidence is provided to me at some point that I cannot still change my mind. You know, it's not this rigid thing where I'm just gonna shout everybody down. You know, because I have friends that are anarchists that consider themselves Christian anarchists. You know, okay, great. If you can find a way to square that with yourself, okay, your belief or lack of belief or multiple beliefs do not affect me in any way, shape, or form. So as long as you're not forcing them upon me, you know, but I'm still open to conversation about these things, because like I said, I don't have any evidence. So I put myself in a certain camp for the time being, but I'm not opposed to being swayed if somebody could provide me a very good argument.
You know, that's kind of a good point, Jay, that people's variety of beliefs only really matter when there's some kind of a central authority that imposes those beliefs on other people on their behalf. So if, you know, if people want to believe whatever, it's only when those people go vote and those beliefs start to affect those people around them that it really becomes an issue. But can you imagine that, you know, if there was no government or concentrated power that imposes the will of our neighbors on us, how much friendlier it would be that everybody comes from some kind of a different background. Okay. It'd be really cool.
Central planning is the death of civility, in my opinion.
That's, you know, people having all these different religious ideas or different economic ideas, even different ideas of all kinds. It's really a cool thing. It's like culture, or it's like hair color. It's really just fine in a free world.
Yeah, I was talking to
even irrational ideas. It doesn't matter. It only matters in this current context, with them having a ballot. Whether or not they actually count the ballots, I don't know. But this is where other beliefs become a problem.
When I talk about, you know, the harmfulness and destruction of laws on people, you know, and I point to, you know, Jim Crow laws and you know, the fact that chain slavery was legal, you know, a lot of people tell me, well, the culture at that time made those laws, right? So today we have a different culture. So therefore they're drawing the conclusion that culture equals government, right? The government creates culture. So therefore, without government, we would be savages, brutes, you know, killing each other, robbing from each other, right? We'd be complete cavemen, you know, revert back to thousands of years ago. And it's amazing that people, they don't see the difference. You know, it's like, no, culture is completely voluntary, right? People choose, you know, languages have evolved for thousands of years, customs have evolved, ways of cooking, different people around the world, you know, have evolved different customs and habits, not because there are laws, but just because that's how people came together and, you know, things evolved. It has nothing to do with laws, regulations, taxes, or politicians whatsoever.
Society exists in spite of government.
Yeah, no, yeah, exactly. I was going to say that. I was actually going to say that I'd posit that many a culture was actually formed, exactly as Dave said, in spite of government.
Yeah.
Many of these cultures came to be...
Or a byproduct of government intervention, you know, like...
Well, yeah, it's... Well,
France used to be this big, dislocated, clusterfuck, which it should be, and then it got central planned and smooshed down into one big mega state under Napoleon, and... You know, it forced all these people. You know, in France, you could walk one town over, and those people weren't speaking the same language. You know, you walk another town over, that they're not speaking it. You know, there's like 154 languages or something all got crushed down to you're speaking French now. You know, it's central planning just robs people of their culture. You know, you just look at like South Africa should be the shining example. You know, English intervention to secure a shipping channel, you know, has caused horrible things upon that area. Apartheid, all kinds of civil wars, unrest, horrible acts on other people, and it's just miserable. It was miserable there for years and years and years, and probably still is for a certain amount of that population. And it's all due to central planning, giving small amount of people so much power over other people.
But, yeah. Yeah, quite right. I mean, when people believe that some people have rights that other people don't have, there is no more equality under the law. Doesn't matter if you write it in a, you know, a document on paper, you scribble it down with a special pen, does not make it so. and I used to, Jeremy was talking about his constitutionalist days. I used to, and I think Dave, you too, right? You got a copy of the Constitution, right? The Bill of Rights, and I did too.
A copy of it. I used to hand them out, man. I bought the jumbo package from Cato when they were selling them for $1 a piece. I think I sent them $100 and they sent me 100 pocket constitutions, and I handed them out as part of Christmas presents. Jesus, man, I was as statist as you get.
Yeah,
I was a constitution humper, as Lufine likes to say.
This is confession hour.
Were you a big fan of the Constitution before your shift, Anam?
You know what? I think that there should be different geographic locations for different ideas. So there's a lot of arguing about, you know, should we be all lefties or righties in America or whatever, or should we be statists at all? And I think that it would be great if people would, instead of fighting over the ideologies and, you know, trying to prove to everyone and get like a conformity of ideas before we like get some kind of positive social changes. It would just be cool if people would just have little areas where they practice their ideas, and then they could just prove their ideas instead of argue them. And so let's say there was some area, let's say Idaho, where everybody in Idaho just said, we're going to secede and have no government. Well, then they could just put into practice the ideas of voluntary association and prove to those around them that these ideas are better. And so I'm not opposed to certain areas having, you know, there should be an area where there's just, they actually live up to the Constitution.
Yeah.
You can't do anything. I probably would move there.
I would.
Yeah, if that was the most free place, I would want to go there.
If it strictly stuck to everything in the Constitution, like to the T, could not operate outside of it, it would be the most free place on the face of the earth. But what have we seen, and I've said it 1,000 times on this show, he who writes the Constitution is the one who interprets it. So, everyone likes to say, oh, if the government just operated in the frame of the Constitution, well, the government interprets the Constitution, so everything that they do is constitutional. because they decide if it is or not. You have no say in it. I don't have any say in it. Danilo, Jared, no one, not even senators have a say in it. You know, whatever the judges in that Supreme Court say is constitutional or not, that's what happens. So, you know, it's, but let's shift from the Constitution and all this. Let's talk about this Pope thing. Pope's in America right now. He's spreading all this bullshit about capitalism being bad. And what he should be saying is not capitalism. He should be saying fascism is bad, because capitalism, as you know, does not exist when you're talking about in the framework of a country's economy. A country's economy and capitalism, they don't work in that. You can't, that sentence or phrase or whatever you say with that, it makes no sense. It's contradictory. So, what's your thoughts on the Pope here, Jeremy?
Well, I mean, I said it before. I guess he's in town. I mean, I know he is, but I really didn't pay much attention to it, because I mean, I know it's a story, but I have heard some of the things that he's said previously, and it's, I mean, so many people are up in arms, but to me, it's like, why worry about what the Pope is saying instead of worrying about why should we be listening to a Pope in the first place? I mean, you know.
Like, I mean, honestly, I have a fire bed or fire ant bed out by my mailbox, and they keep getting into my mailbox and like stinging me when I get my mail out. I care more about the plight of those ants than I do about the Pope breathing air or existing, really.
Well, to tie back to what Anam was saying about, you know, everybody should have a place. Well, I wouldn't go that far with the Pope. I mean, if he wants to spout his stuff, great. If people want to follow him, great. I'm not, but. A lot of people, I mean, it's just funny because he purports himself, obviously, well, at least he shows himself to be very, I guess, socialist in nature, and it seems to be coming out a lot more, at least more so than I can recall any other Pope having commentary on stuff like this. I remember Pope John Paul II, from what I remember, was just whenever he came to town, like I said, it was a big deal for my grandmother. So that's why I remember it. And then who is it? The Ratzinger guy after him, who ended up quitting. I don't remember much. I don't remember much out of him other than the talk that he had been in the Hitler Youth, which can't really be held against him because everybody was in the Hitler Youth because the parents were under scrutiny if they weren't, you know, like, so you can't really say, oh, he was in the Hitler Youth, that makes him a bad guy. Well, you were kind of forced to be, but I don't remember much about him. And then the scandal,
is that like the Obama Youth?
No, not the same.
Obama's kids.
But with this one, he seems to be, I mean, at least maybe it's just because I view the media differently now than I had when previous
what,
popes
do you look
were
like
in
this
power.
Or what?
No, it's usually upside down. But what, you know, I guess, like I said, maybe it's just that I'm paying attention differently. So I hear a lot more about this. So, you know, he has made a lot of commentary in the past, and I'm assuming he's made similar ones since he's been here this time, about climate change, about, you know, the economy and inequality, you know, which is, these are leftist terms. These are, you know, it's focused on this equality, which doesn't exist. Yes, you're right.
Why would a Christian care about climate change when, you know, the Bible clearly states that the world's going to get burned up and remade, and, you know, so it'll be basically a safe haven for, it's going to be the new world as Jesus is king, you know, so it makes no sense. Like, who cares what shape the world's in as long as Jesus comes back, right?
Well, I don't think I've come across a Catholic or a Christian who actually follows everything that supposedly the Bible's supposed to do anyway, so I don't know if you can really ask that question, why do they care? Why do they care? Because where does he come from?
We just need to get back to the Bible.
Yeah, just get back to following the Bible to the T, and everything will be fine. I mean, where is he from originally? Venezuela or Argentina?
Argentina.
You know, he's South American. All the South American Catholics, they're all very socialist. That's just the way that's the way that culture is down there. You know, that, so he espouses these ideas, and now he's on a world stage.
Well, not to mention Argentina is like a economic shithole right now because
well, not
the
right.
government's
not
done
just right now. It's been that way
well,
for
the
a
government
while.
No, the government has propped up so many companies there by printing money that it's just out of control. So you can see why he has an actual gripe with what he thinks is capitalism, but that's not capitalism.
Well, you know? Of course, but
anyone that understands it can look at it and see plain as day that the Pope is not talking about capitalism. He's talking about corporatism. He's talking about fascism. Those are the same thing.
Well, yeah, true. But then when you get, but then you look at it from that aspect and say, okay, well, he's confused. But then again, this is why I tend to stay away from these conversations and stay away from this him in general. Because then you could go down the rabbit hole of, in different veins of conspiracy from there. Well, is he just economically illiterate or does he know? Because, you know, there's a lot of talk that the Vatican wields a lot of power in this world and has for a very long time, especially for a very tiny little place on the map. They have an extreme amount of power and influence on the world. So does he actually believe the things he's saying, or is he just spouting?
Does any politician?
Well, that's what I'm saying. You never know. So
yeah, I mean, you don't get Pope without a little politicking. So,
no, come on, man. He's ordained by God. White smoke, gray smoke, whatever the hell they do over there. It's not. There's no politics involved.
Hey, you're
that.
The Catholic here, not me, buddy. Okay, I was born Baptist, and you know, like you were saying earlier about that, I was trying to say, you know, I used to get a beating with a belt if I refused to go to church. So there was like, religion is crazy. It makes people do crazy things.
That's not religion being crazy. That was your parents being crazy. Let's not take away their moral agency on that one there, Dave.
They had good intentions, I guess. So, Anam, anything on the Pope?
People like to choose someone to defer their responsibility to.
That is what is wrong with this world. Everyone's scared of responsibility. 100%. I agree.
Then they listen to them, and maybe more so than to their own logic or reasoning.
Actually,
so there's somebody saying certain things.
I saw a meme that this guy that I interviewed from libertyhangout.com, he posted a meme with Pope and Bernie Sanders shaking hands, Pope and what's his name, and Obama shaking hands, and they're like church and state, right? Supposedly there's been separation, right? But when the state is a church, then there really has not been a separation, right? Because you have all the same identical symbolism, you know, with the flag, with the politicians, with the sacrificial lambs, with all the different biblical terms, completely identical place of indoctrination, right? You know, the government school. So go down the line. It's really amazing how all the parallels that you can list.
Money. It's fiat money is the new god, and government is the theocracy for that. No. Government is always a theocracy. I got a new idea. Government's always a theocracy. The god just changed. You know, like the reason there was the Dark Ages is because the Catholic Church owned all of the Europe. And ran it as a theocracy, same way with any kind of caliphate, any kind of Saudi Arabia, anything. The king is appointed by God, the royal family, all this. Money changes those. So like what you're seeing is what we saw when fiat money came along is all the theocracy based in, you know, magical sky gods crushed. And but the family still supported it. And now you have these huge fiat-based states that everyone prays to, essentially. They tithe to, what do you think taxes are? So money is the fiat money. Easy money is the new god.
It's new, but it's not new. Been around for hundreds of years, fiat money, and maybe they're starting to perfect it. Maybe they're the propaganda is getting a little bit better. But certainly not a new concept. I think divine right of kings has shifted. Now it's the divine right of politicians. Democracy. I'd say democracy is the new god. And I think Larken Rose did a video about the gospel of government, right?
The God called government.
No. He was reading from a book. He was like, now we're going to read the gospel of government. this is book one from part one from the book of politicians. It was great. It is the divine right of politicians. You know, we still do have a modern day aristocracy. It's not called an aristocracy, right? It's called Congress. It's called, you know, politicians. And people feel like, you know, if we vote every 4 or 6 years, that we have a say. You know, these people are us. They're just us, right? We are the government. We can vote them in, right? If you want, you can be president. Right. If you're sociopathic enough, if you lack empathy, you
went to Harvard or Yale.
You too can be a mass murderer.
What was Jimmy Carter was the only president that didn't go to Harvard or Yale? I think I can't or before oh, really? The or after the schools were made.
Well, schools have been around for a very long time. I don't know the statistics on that. I care less about the presidents than I do about the Pope. but yeah, I mean, of course, I mean what you guys are saying, that's, I mean, the modern day, the modern state just replaced the powerful religions, because there were, you know, the theocracies and the religions used to rule the planet, and then it shifted to the state. And yeah, you can see the parallels. But to go taking it back to something Anam was talking about earlier, I think that's why the idea of panarchy is so appealing, because, you know, there's all these different things and people want to believe all this different stuff. Let them. Let's all go into our own little sections and prove what works.
Yeah.
Most people are terrified. Even if you bring that idea to them, they'll immediately shoot it down. And I think that for a lot of them, there's a deep-seated fear that they know what they're following, what they're believing in, what they're preaching may not actually be right. And they may find out if they're forced into that. Like people like us, when you say, hey, give us Idaho, give us anywhere, give us an actual free state that we can set up camp and prove our wares, we're all, people like us are like, yes, let's do it, all right.
But that's such a huge threat to collectivists, because they know their ideology relies on the productive people staying trapped within their geographical control. So as soon as you have some area that the productive people can go to that they don't want interference of government, then the place that we left, that, you know, we are the people they wanted to steal from.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
so you'll hear
Idaho.
Just gonna take your ball and go home. Like, we're poor sports for not wanting to get robbed.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, if you did make Idaho a free state, let's just say, or a geographical location with no political class. Let's just say that, because I think that would probably be the best way to describe it. The minute all the companies move their corporate headquarters there, where there's no corporate taxes, all that place is going to get fucking, there's going to be false flags, etc., etc. The whole country that didn't move in there, the rest of the people are going to be whipped into a frenzy. Oh, those Idahoans, they're crazy. They're killing everybody. They're evil. They're letting all kinds of riffraff in this, you know. You know, this is part of the United States. We can't protect it if we don't, you know. It would just be exactly what you said. The collectivists have to use force to even entertain their ideas, because 90% of statist ideas never hit they never come to fruition because of all the corruption and bullshit.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I wasn't even thinking in the terms. I mean, it's a great point about the collective nature of certain people, but I was thinking even on a smaller scale, like the people that would say that, even people that would say they're minarchists, but, you know, they want, you know, little amount of government. If you gave them the option to say, hey, what if we take this spot over here and you take this spot over here, and then you let the people that you consider statists take this spot over here, I think a lot of those people would fear that, because I think a lot of people do question their beliefs more than they let on, but it's so much, they're so inundated with you know, propaganda. No, it's not even the fear. It's
fear.
You're constantly inundated with information, useless information, you know, entertainment, propaganda, all this stuff that's by design to keep people off balance and keep them from thinking and keep them from focusing. So I think a lot of people do, maybe that's just my optimistic nature at looking in the good and looking for the good in people, but I think a lot of people do have doubts about the paradigm that they find themselves in, but it's just so much easier to turn that off and just focus on the Kardashians or whatever other bullshit is going on out there and not think about it. But if given the opportunity, I'd like to see that happen. You know, the same thing, you know, where you say people that are believe their strict adherence to the Constitution and believe that they just need to get back there and everything will be okay. Okay. Give them that opportunity. Give them a spot. Say, okay, this spot's yours. Run it. See how it goes. I don't know how many of them would be that excited about it, because, you know, even the people that believe in this particular violent protection racket that they call a government and live here and believe that it's necessary, and believe the BS that we were all taught in school about, you know, how things went down and how the United, you know, the United States is now exceptional because it overcame all these things. Well, wasn't the whole idea originally supposed to be once it reached the full level, these 50 laboratories, wasn't that supposed to be the idea where everybody got to do things kind of their own way and figured out what worked and what doesn't? Like, that just always blows my mind that that some of the statists that believe in this stuff, when you tell them to look at that and go, well, when was that opportunity ever presented? When did that actually happen? Because it was talked about a lot, but the Supreme Court was always ruling things down and saying, well, no, you can't actually do that. Well, wait a minute. I thought we were supposed to be able to do what we wanted regardless of what you guys said. But it just goes right over their head, because again, the next big thing comes on the news, the next distraction comes up, and they go, oh, okay, we'll worry about that later. And you know, another generation goes by and things
something,
are even worse.
Something Caitlyn Jenner. Something, something.
Yeah.
So but yeah. Why do you guys think that things are the way they are now?
Fear and complacency.
What's that?
All the confusion and the conflict over right versus left. Why do we have the certain
fear
economic reality right now? Why do we have certain political reality that we do right now? How do you guys think this came about? Is it because the people are inept? Is this all kind of a culmination of accidents?
It's a mixture of protectionism, fear, and indoctrination. So, like, go look at any political ad at the during this election cycle and tell me how it's not, hey, if you don't vote Republican, those evil maniacal Democrats are going to get in control and they're going to fuck everything up. They're going to screw your savings. They're going to do all this and that and that. And then that's fear. And then on the other hand, you got Democrats. Oh, if you don't vote for us, the Republicans are going to kick out all these poor, helpless immigrants. They're going to give the corporations a free break on everything. They're going to screw over all this free stuff that we're giving out. It's all fear. It's like, oh God, I can't have my pension be wiped out by the Republicans, or I can't have my Social Security check stop. I'll starve. It's all fear. And once you get people to see that, you know, the emperor doesn't wear any clothes, those fear goggles come off.
I think a lot of politics come from the mindset that there's something wrong that has to be corrected. And I think everybody's operating under that kind of narrative. But I kind of have a different perspective. I think that everything is going exactly as it is supposed to. This is the perfect plan. This is how I would rule things if I was trying to be a ruler. I would set it up exactly like this. I would think of all the different kinds of division there are going on right now. People are becoming polarized on almost every topic. But if you were the ruler or part of a ruling family, wouldn't you do something? Your first priority would be to set up a system that hid you. The kings were always under attack because everyone knew who the king was. Mm-hmm. You know, and then we're told this story the kings granted Parliament special powers to, really? I mean, think about that. Think about all the stuff we heard in history about how people gradually gained more and more control.
You got to look at.
But we take those things. We take the history that we're given in school for granted, like that. You know, the Magna Carta. Mm-hmm. Like people got like the right to vote over certain things, and they kept the king more or less as a figurehead. Oh, maybe all that stuff is false. Maybe what happened was the people at the top are better at ruling than we are at figuring it out. Maybe they're better at keeping themselves hidden than we are at figuring it out. And maybe all of this illusion of democracy is just that. Maybe somebody, because they didn't have to work all day, had the free time to think up a plan of how to keep themselves hidden. And so they put together this system, and in different countries it's different system. Maybe that's in the consideration of culture or whatever, but they kind of put this these people in between them and the population. Mm-hmm. So let's say there is a couple ruling families that rule the world right now. Wouldn't this system be perfect for them, where sure. They could control everybody by keeping everybody thinking that they are somehow in control? This is the number one point of creating a mind matrix. Make the people, first of all, turn yourself invisible so that the people will always cast the blame for problems on some other group. Then you create a system where the people can believe they're trading that group in and out every 4 years or every 8 years or whatever. Make it so that their choices are just two, with maybe an outlier to cause occasional confusion. But basically just the dichotomy of a two-party system. Countries, there's more parties, but it's really keep the people going back and forth. And that's total government control of the mind. And if you can control the mind, you can control everything.
Yeah.
So everybody keeps on arguing about everything because they're trying to correct some anomaly that has gone, something that has gone awry. We were on the right track, but, you know, the Democrats got in control and then things got messed up. Or the Republicans got in control and then things got messed up. But in reality, nothing's messed up. Things are going exactly according to plan. And if you just think about it, not as the subject trying to figure it out, but think about it from the perspective of the ruler, I really find it helps a lot when you start to imagine scenarios from the obverse angle or the converse angle. Mm-hmm. I'm a real estate investor. I'll tell you how I came to this perspective of trying to figure things out by flipping them inside out. So I'm sitting there in a loan officer's office, and I'm hearing him talk to the actual lender about my file. So I'm the investor. I'm trying to buy properties, and he has the mortgage broker is a middleman, and he has my file with all of my qualifications, all my job history, all of my income information, all of my creditworthiness. He has this file, right? And he's talking to the lender and about me. And so we normally believe, like as a home buyer, that the home is the product, that we are the customer, that the lender facilitates the transaction by giving us this loan. That's the paradigm that we are given. But while I'm sitting there hearing the mortgage broker talk to the lender, it just dawned on me. I'm the product. The lender is the customer. The subscription of an interest-based mortgage payment that will be coming from me, the subscription is actually what the lender is trying to buy. By buying me the product, they're trying to buy the benefit of the product. That's that monthly subscription coming in. So I realized that this whole scenario is actually backwards. And I am the product. that my file, that's the marketing for the product. The salesman is actually the mortgage broker trying to sell the product with the marketing to the lender. Realizing this, that things can often be actually exactly the opposite of the paradigm we're given, has really helped me to see things in a way that makes a lot more sense. When we look at the world under the narrative that they gave us, nothing makes sense. Nothing adds up. It really is like every single moment is like in the Matrix, that movie, The Matrix, when the cat walks by twice, exactly the same, and he realizes, wait a second, there is a glitch there. Well, it kind of seems like under the normal narrative, it seems like there's glitches all over the place. Nothing kind of adds up. But when you switch your perspective to that of how would things be if you were the ruler, everything adds up perfectly. The difference in religion, that the Pope is here saying certain things, that that there's all this contention over which economic ideas are right, that there's Republicans and Democrats, and there's a power swing back and forth. Things are really messed up. And from the layman's perspective, it's hard to figure out why. Well, it's hard to figure out why, because they're not actually messed up. It's all.
Have you read Larken's book?
Yeah, I was thinking about that too.
How to Be a Successful Tyrant.
Right.
No, but I'll take this opportunity to give Larken Rose a huge shout out. Huge props to Larken Rose. I think he's one of the most effective communicators of these ideas. So I love Larken Rose. He's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. In that book, he says the way I would control people is split them up and make them mad at each other and let them pick who is going to lead my system and sit back and rake in the rewards. And if you follow that to its logical conclusion now, if you use the same strategy, who is in control of this country right now? It's the Federal Reserve.
Or the people above that.
Yeah, whoever owns the Federal Reserve. Yeah, exactly. So names like Rothschilds and all this other stuff start getting thrown around, and you look, wait, who owns the Bank of England? Oh, the Rothschilds. Who owns the Bank of France? Oh, the Rothschilds. So you start seeing all these puppet governments, you know, and, you know, what does the United States do? They go in, they knock down Saddam Hussein, they put in their puppet. They go down and knock down whoever the hell it was in Afghanistan, and they put in their puppet. It'll be soon before Ayatollah Khomeini is knocked down and they put in their puppet in Iran. So I fully expect a war with Iran. I know the people aren't going to want it in a large majority. It'll probably be a 50-50 split like everything's supposed to be. I mean, look at the last, six or seven presidential elections have all been like 49-51. It's working perfectly.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, what you were saying before, I mean, about, you know, if there are, you know, say there's some families, whatever, I think you can end up getting in the weeds, you know, as Dave was saying, well, you know, who is in charge? Honestly, I don't think it matters, because there's definitely somebody or some group of somebodies that are doing something. It just, as you said, everything just lines up a little too well when you look at it from that perspective for it not to be. But the one thing you said about, you know, keeping yourself hidden, I mean, the one thing that kept playing through my head is, what's that quote? What's the greatest trick the devil ever played? Making people believe he didn't exist. You know, that's exactly what it is. You know, a lot of people would hear this and go immediately say, oh, tinfoil hat, I don't need to listen to this. Well, no, you look at the evidence, you look at the history, you look at how it just always seems that certain patterns keep happening. And it doesn't matter where it is, it doesn't matter who it is, that's the face of the government or the power or whatever it is at the time. Things just they keep seeming to happen the same way. So it would make a lot more sense that there's somebody or a group of somebodies that are actually playing this out. But like you said too, it lines up very well when you look at it from that perspective. And that Larken book, the guys mentioned, it talks about that same thing. It talks about that, the whole idea of looking at it from the perspective of the tyrant, looking at the perspective from the megalomaniac. Yes, mm-hmm. this is perfect. I mean, that's why I'm a big fan of the works of Spooner and his take on the Constitution and the whole idea that, well, maybe it was set up to do exactly what it's doing. And I fully believe that. I fully believe that this system in particular, I mean, I am not as well versed in the systems of other countries just from the general researching I've done, but you can see the patterns there too. But, you know, talking about here specifically, well, yeah, if you look at it, it sure as heck looks like when you take out the emotional garbage and all the propaganda and the rhetoric and you just look at the facts, well, yeah, it sure as heck does look like this is exactly what was supposed to happen. You're just, once you concentrate power, it's just going to keep getting concentrated and concentrated. And it's just, the only way to sustain itself is to continue to oppress the people that are under it. So, I fully believe that this particular system was set up to work this way. And when you look around the world, it looks like a lot of the other systems, the same patterns. It's just always... Any glimpse or hint of freedom is usually quickly squelched and reversed, and things start heading back towards a system of tyranny until enough people get pissed off. They don't know exactly why. They go for the violent revolution, and then you have the power vacuum. And
everybody's familiar with that scene in The Wizard of Oz where the people are all looking at the wizard and the dog decides to go over and pull the green curtain back to see the guy that's actually controlling, you know, the wizard. I think that's a great analogy. And it doesn't really matter who it is.
Be the dog.
And it doesn't even actually matter if this idea about one or two families controlling everything is correct. I don't think the correctness of an idea is the only thing that matters about the idea, but if the effects of the idea create positive change, then it's at least worth looking at as an idea. So without being a full-on committed conspiracy theorist and believing wholeheartedly that, yeah, certain families are controlling everything and they drink babies' blood and they answer to Satan and all that stuff, right? Just... We can see that it's a fact that when we concentrate power, people who crave power take it over. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they're usually the worst among us.
Oh, yeah, look at all the
that should just be the main message, you know, like let's quit doing that.
Yeah, it's the fruit versus the root, and people always are trying to cut the fruit off the tree instead of strike at the roots. And, you know, when you break these arguments down into very simple things like Larken does, it strikes at the root. It's, you know, forget all this bullshit, this political rhetoric and all this other stuff that's used to distract you. Strike at the roots. What's the big problems here? And as you can see, central planning through different stages of the Earth's history has always been the problem. What do you think all the history books are written about? They're written about the failures or the successes of central planning. Now, would we have put a man on the moon or satellites without some kind of central planning? I don't know. Who knows? But just because something good happens because of a, you know, bad action doesn't mean that the bad action should happen again.
Yeah. So the thief says, you know, my your money I'm going to take and you know, it's going to go to my grandmother who's sick. It doesn't really matter. There's a meme that I found which it says society is like a stew. It must be stirred every once in a while or else scum rises to the top. and I really like that. But yeah, I think maybe we should wrap this up and you know, everybody can give their final remarks. But yeah, that's an interesting idea, you know, Anna, when talking about from the perspective of the ruler. I don't tend to think of it like that too much, but you know, I that is helpful though to think, because yeah, people all too often, you know, they have this idea that the, you know, most people or most people who go into office, public office, are you know, kind-hearted, compassionate, and, you know, good intentions. Benevolent. Right, and benevolent, right. And it's interesting that the people who think that, they think that those people are necessary because most of humanity is evil and malicious and would rob from you at the first chance, but they don't see the obvious contradiction. Wait a minute. So most people are evil, but only good people are attracted to power, right? Extreme power, the most sophisticated military in the history of the world. Only good people want to get into that kind of power. Right. That makes sense. Okay.
Hey, look here, sir. My warlord is a benevolent warlord. All right?
Right. So it's you know, I think it was Mises, right? If you discount, you know, every you know, if you discount people from being free based on their fallibility, then you must discount every government action on the same you know, by the same basis, right? Yeah. So you know, you have to apply this consistently throughout, right? You can't make exceptions, right? And another way to look at it is, you know, if people are fundamentally evil, then no government composed of evil could be considered legitimate. Or if people are fundamentally good, you know, government is unnecessary. So either way, it doesn't work.
So Anam, I ask every guest we have, what's your favorite quote? And I'm asking you that now. What's your favorite quote there, guy?
Okay, well, the one that comes to mind is the one by Buckminster Fuller about creating a new paradigm that makes the old one obsolete.
Yeah, I mean, that's, create a new paradigm, and which is basically just a plea to capitalism, which isn't a fallacy, in my opinion. But, you know, the better idea is going to win in the market.
Right.
And I think that's what's happening with governments. You're seeing they're trying to grab hold harder, but the internet is making things, the free exchange of ideas is making that ball too big for those hands to hold. And I think that what we're talking about will be laughable in 50 years, 60 years maybe. I think a huge paradigm shift and a lot of tragedy is going to happen, but I think the ball is just going to get too big for the evildoers, as Bush would say, to handle, you know? Yeah, so the central banking is getting phased out by Bitcoin. I mean, it's happening. All these huge banks are now putting all their shit on the blockchain. What's going to happen when they can't lie about what they've got in their bank account because it's all in the blockchain? So it's, you know, their technology is killing central planning because, you know, Amazon, you can order something in the next day it's here. That almost beats brick and mortar stores unless you need something immediately. So all this central planning of, you know, like, oh, we need this business over here and we need a zoning committee for this and all that. I need a big factory where I can put drones and stuff and get somebody something in 30 minutes.
Well, you've seen the dissemination of power happen all over the place in the market, like with Airbnb is the mm-hmm. biggest hotelier in the world now, and they own no hotels.
Right.
Yeah.
And Uber is the biggest taxi cab company in the world.
Yeah, it's so threatening to that protectionism.
Well, that's
you know, Uber is also, they're culprit for using protectionism because Uber is a trademarked name, etc. So I can't open up I can't make an Uber app and compete with Uber. So that's why
you can compete with Uber.
That's monopolizing a name.
Okay, but you can't.
Who enforces that monopoly?
Okay, that's irrelevant though, because you can't hold that against them. That's the way the game is currently played.
I understand in a pragmatic way. Yeah.
No, not even a pragmatic. That's the way the game is played. You can't get around that. That's reality right now. But that's why I was going to say that's why Uber is getting challenged in so many places, because it's a threat to the paradigm. But they are. Those things are great, and that's what needs to happen. That's
what was it, San Francisco? If they catch you doing Airbnb, they lock your ass up. They'll take your property from you.
I have no idea.
Which, I mean, that's San Francisco, which is, I mean, pretty authoritarian. So,
well, they're very confused over there. There's still, and I know there's still a huge hippie community. Well, no, there's a huge hippie community there that thinks they're against the system, but they're still playing into the system.
They probably don't even have a pet sitting agency over there.
Oh, I bet you there's some inside joke. Sorry about
Jeremy's
that.
Jeremy's in demand.
I'm not. I don't care if they don't. I'm not going to San Francisco. I know. I've been listening to. I've been listening to Derek J talk about it. And the rent's out. He just moved out there recently. The rent is just insane out there. There's no way I'm going out to San Francisco. It's bad enough here in New York. I don't want to go deal with.
Oh God, you guys. I freak out at you guys living in New York.
Well,
so I really appreciate you coming on such short notice, Anam. It was a really cool conversation we had. I really dig with what you say, man. You got a lot of good things to say.
Thanks very much for having me on. You know what? I want to take an opportunity to mention to the listeners that I'm currently working on an app that allows people to find each other on a map based on affinity. So after going to Anarchapulco, and I was a speaker there. I'm sure you guys are familiar with the event.
Awesome. Mm-hmm.
So after coming back to my little town, after this, you know, it was a huge experience for me to be in a room with 300 other anarchists. Everybody, it's crazy. I don't know if you guys have been together with that many of our kind at one time, but it's an amazing
Liberty experience. Fest, I guess, right?
No, not even Liberty Fest, because Liberty Fest is half Big L libertarians.
Right,
no,
Anarchapulco
is something that's
right.
I'm very jealous that you made. I so wished I could have made it there.
Yeah.
It was an incredible experience to be. It's crazy because when you meet other anarchists, you're speaking the same language. When you're having a conversation, you don't have to build the foundation for those concepts that you'll be sharing. It's already ready.
Right. Everybody's tiresome.
Instantly brothers and sisters. So It was an amazing experience. And when I came back, I went through a couple weeks of kind of a blues kind of state where, you know, I didn't want to go hang out with statists, and I don't have very many anarchists where I live. I didn't want to go spend my money in statist owned shops and cafes and stuff. So I found myself just kind of
playing video games. No,
basically, I was wishing there was a way to just find other people of our kind on a map, or just to know if they were around me. Because, you know, we know each other on Facebook, but it's not easy to find out where someone happens to be located on Facebook. It's not really ideal for meeting people in real life.
You're gonna have let me take a little air out of your tires here. You're going to have anarchists that are going to see this and go, yeah, I'm not doing this. I mean,
I understand the concerns, but here's what I was motivated to do. I was motivated to create an app that allows anybody to find anybody based on affinity. So if you happen to like mountain biking, you can find other mountain bikers. And I understand that we are particularly concerned with privacy. So while you're creating a profile yourself, you don't get to put a name, you don't have to put a picture, it's just a set of affinities. And you can choose where you put it on a map, and you can choose how accurate it is. So also, it's if you find someone else that has a common affinity with you, let's say that they show up within a block or so, you can touch on their marker on the flag or on the map and open up a dialogue with them. This dialogue is sent through an encrypted shard messaging service. Mm-hmm. So you can open up a little dialogue with them, basically like a text that says, hey, I'm also interested in mountain biking. Would you like to meet up and maybe go on a mountain bike ride?
That beats my app idea pretty badly.
So for us, it could be, you know, I know that we probably wouldn't put our location very accurately. We might put it within a mile or two, or maybe just somewhere in a general location, maybe around that floats around the city we happen to live in, just so others can know we live there. You can meet at a public place like a park, decide if you actually like them or if they're actually an anarchist or not. But think about how divided we are, because we don't know where each other are. I might have anarchists that I would love to make my very close friends living next door, but I may never know that the way things are right now. The way we make friends right now, it's all by accident. You try to become friends with people who happen to be at your school or at your job. And those are actually terrible reasons to try to make a friendship with somebody. So finding people based on your affinities, it's like looking on a map and finding people who are already your friends. So we've thought about all the security concerns and the privacy issues. Those are actually paramount importance to us. So if anybody wants to check this out, it's coming out by the end of the year, and it's called Connector.
I have an idea. It's called Connector. I have an idea. What if you could set it by GPS, but it didn't pinpoint your location? It just said, hey, I'm within this 20-mile radius.
It does that.
Oh, okay. All right. That's cool.
When you're setting up, you go through and you choose the things like activities that you like to do. You choose if you want to share what kind of politics you like to talk about. So it kind of goes through a whole gamut of these different things that you can like, so that other people can see you and see. And basically, it's not seeing you; it's just seeing a marker with a set of these statuses that you choose to put on there. So it's not even necessarily you. Mm-hmm. And we're setting it up so that our server doesn't get any information about you. So that if we were ever asked, we have nothing to actually report on.
Very cool.
So,
I like it.
Coming from an anarchist perspective and a little bit of a conspiracy-minded perspective, I thought about all of the potential problems that I'm sure automatically come to all of our type of minds, but they've all been addressed. But so this would be a new way to find people who are already your friends, and. Yeah, like I said, you could make it so that you're just telling people, hey, I'm somewhere in this 20-mile radius, and we can meet up at a public place if you want to talk about whatever. It could be underwater basketball, could be politics, could be mountain biking or something like that.
Very cool.
I'm very passionate about Pilates.
And places to find businesses that kind of... cater to people in your crowd as well. So it's going to have lots of considerations, and it's going to be useful by everybody.
Very, very cool.
Connector.
Cool. Connector. I'll be sure to download it.
Do you have a website set up for it already, or is that still in the works?
It's still in the works. There's a Facebook page for it though. Connector on Facebook.
Cool. All right.
We'll put a link to that in the show notes.
Very.
All right. Well, I would also like to thank you for coming on. This was a really great conversation. I would also encourage anybody, especially if you have kids or even if you don't, to we'll put links to in the show notes this, but go check out Anam's book. I am, as I've said a couple times already, I'm a huge fan of it. I think even for people, even if you don't have kids yourself, if you have kids in your life, nephews, nieces, friends who have kids, just pick it up and just pass it out. I think it's well worth the money. I like I said, I would highly encourage other people to pick it up, even if you don't have kids. Even you, Dave, I think even you could benefit from this book. So that's my plug for you. Like I said, it was a really great conversation. I really appreciate you coming on, and. Yeah, my parting words, fuck the Pope.
Thanks a lot, Anam. It's very nice talking to you. This is the first time I heard about that book. I can't believe it. But I encourage everyone to
Liar, you've heard about it multiple times.
Buy it in the style of Jeremy by the hundreds. Okay.
Buy it with Bitcoin. Buy it with Bitcoin.
Pass it out to your friends at family reunions.
Yes.
Yeah.
Would be nice. So I'll get mine soon. But thanks a lot for coming on the show. It's really wonderful speaking with you. So if anybody wants to help us out, we would be most grateful. You can do so through Bitcoin or Patreon. We have the links below. Any help would be much appreciated.
$1 a month, guys. $1 one month. That's all we ask. If we have 100 people doing that, it makes our stuff free.
Makes a big
difference. It helps lift the heavy burden of hosting and all this from us.
Sound like a socialist, Dave. Nothing is free.
of course, you're right. We're putting in a lot of effort here, so we're gonna get paid in donations here. But if you want to help, patreon.com/seeds of liberty, and just click on that donate $1 a month thing. That'd be awesome. We already have a couple of people doing it, and it's really helping out.
Yep, we're not asking for 10% of your income. You know, $1 a month is sufficient. If everybody donates $1 a month, it's a wonderful, wonderful help. You can also like, comments, and subscribe to the channel, and that will help boost our rankings as well. So thanks a lot for listening. Thank you, Anna, for coming on the show. So this is Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.